Listening to BBC Radio Suffolk, it's Claire Phillips here this afternoon for Rachel Sloane, who would have been sitting in on afternoons. Sadly, lost her voice, unfortunately, but pleased to say that her sofa guest that she'd invited into the studio, an old colleague of, I use the term old loosely, of course, from the Radio Orwell days, and indeed a familiar voice here on BBC Radio Suffolk, because it's someone who will be known to many radio listeners in the county, having worked in broadcasting for 40 years, some of them here at BBC Radio Suffolk, but most notably, as I mentioned, on the commercial stations serving the county, starting at Radio Orwell, and then his career took him from Ipswich to Colchester, but then much further afield to Cyprus, the Falkland Islands, and then to Canada, from where he's recently returned to Suffolk. So it's lovely to welcome back to BBC Radio Suffolk, Nigel Rennie. Hello,
Thank
Nigel.
Thank you, Claire. Very nice to see you. And 15 years we worked out earlier on.
I know, 15 years since you and I last worked in a radio studio together, and that was probably him, possibly at our sister station BBC Essex,
yeah,
where you also...
And I recognised you straight away. You haven't changed, Claire.
Oh, it's very kind of you to say so, Nigel. I mean, you, I mentioned to James Hazel earlier that you were popping in, and he remembered working with you as well, and mentioned your North Yorkshire roots. Now, I mean, you've managed to blend into Suffolk very well from somebody who was... born in North Yorkshire.
But well, that's right,
you,
yeah.
You moved to the county as a child, I think, didn't
yeah,
you?
Yeah, we came down here in the early 70s with my parents. Dad used to work for Fison's, the fertiliser people who don't exist anymore.
No.
That brought us down to Suffolk in the early 70s from Lincolnshire initially, but we've been living up in North Yorkshire before that.
So your background was very much in the sort of farming and agriculture.
My grandparents were dairy farmers near Tadcaster, which is not very far from York, and Dad's job was involved in agriculture, and I think everybody thought I would do the same thing, but I had other ideas.
Got
the radio bug very early on.
Did your family want you to? I mean, was there a family farm, your grandparents' farm or whatever, to take over that they thought?
No, not really. That was more on my mum's side. I did, when I was very young, this is sort of in my early teens, kept pigs for a while and bred pigs and sold them off to market. And I actually got my first record player with the money from selling those pigs.
So it sort of means to an end then.
Well, that's just right.
A bit of entrepreneurship to help you to pursue your chosen career.
Yeah, and I think everybody thought perhaps Nigel's going to go into pig farming. But there was other things that grabbed my attention.
Right part of the world for that, of course, if you had have chosen pig farming.
Very much so.
What inspired you to take up a, you know, when did you decide that you wanted to go into radio?
Well, it's funny, isn't it? They always say from an acorn grows. And this was back in the 60s, back in the days of the offshore radio stations, if you like. And up in Yorkshire, we had our own station, which was off the coast of Scarborough on one of the ships. And we used to listen all the time. It was the thing to do. It was a fantastic time to be a youngster, although, as I say, I was very young at the time. But it gave me that initial interest in radio and music in particular. And it just sort of stayed with me, and it was something that I felt, yeah, I really wanted to do that. I was fascinated by the medium.
I think for people who kind of grew up in that generation of the switch from the offshore stations perhaps to the coming on air of things like Radio 1 and then the growth of commercial radio, quite a time to be a radio listener that we're never going to have again.
It was a magic time, Claire, you're right. I mean, everybody talks about Radio Luxembourg, and it used to fade at night, but everybody used to listen anyway. The reception was dreadful at times, to be honest with you. You used to listen under the bedclothes, and it was the music and it was the whole magic. It was the informality of the whole thing.
Yeah.
Never to be repeated, sadly.
And were there any particular disc jockeys who inspired you? Any voices that, you know, you'd always make sure you didn't miss their show?
Well, it's funny, isn't it? Everybody talks about the likes of Tony Blackburn, Kenny Everett, of course, what a master. But it has to be Johnny Walker. He was always a big favourite of mine. That sort of presenter, and another name who'll be familiar to you, because I know you've worked with him for a few years as well, Andy Archer,
yes,
who was somebody I used to listen to on the radio when I first came down to Suffolk. And what a broadcaster. you know, a true pro, a real character. I think that's probably
yes,
a fair way of putting it as
yes.
well. But what a broadcaster.
Yeah, and as you say, Kenny Everett, the likes of which we won't see again, I'm sure. But certainly, I mean, my love of radio grew from an early age, just listening to the sort of thing that you know, we don't hear as much on the radio. There are still some very talented broadcasters out there.
Yeah, absolutely right.
But radio has changed a great deal.
Yeah, and a lot of it, I say, is personality-led. That doesn't mean anything against radio presenters with personality, but a lot of people from TV, musicians, singers have now become broadcasters and just lost its way slightly.
What did your parents say when you said, I'm thinking of going into radio? Were you were you encouraged?
Honestly, my dad was completely against it. He would never admit it. Sadly, he's no longer with us, but he would never admit it at the time. He thought I ought to think about getting a proper job, not being one of these prattling disc jockey types. But to be perfectly honest, Claire, that probably gave me even more incentive to do something that I wanted to do.
Yeah.
And it was so difficult in those days to get that break.
Yes.
Maybe it's a bit of luck involved and, you know, you've got to have some talent as well. But it was not easy in those days.
It's not easy. And I know from my own experience, going to the school careers teacher and they say, what do you want to do? I want to work in radio. That kind of wasn't on their list of just suitable jobs for somebody.
Yeah, not on the radar at all. I had a similar thing. They suggested I was a chef. Now, where that came from, I've no idea. Somebody else said a policeman. All great professions, nothing wrong with them, but nobody ever mentioned anything about radio because it was something that people didn't really understand.
And how did you start?
Well, when we came down to Suffolk, which was, early part of the 70s, I was very keen to get involved in hospital radio here in Ipswich, which is still going strong. Mm. Great organisation as well. And I know friends of mine who've been with hospital radio for, well, as long as I've been broadcasting, still doing it to this day, which is fantastic. So a great way to learn about radio, an unofficial training ground, if you like. That gave me the background, and when Rennie Warwell came on air in 1975, I was knocking on the door. Didn't get a full-time job straight away, but it gave me a foot in the door, made the tea and generally made myself familiar with everybody else.
And this was based in Ipswich. Was this the old electric house building?
The old electric house. And every time I walk past that building, it still brings back those memories. What a great place to work, in the bowels of Electric House.
Yeah, see, I never worked for Radio Orwell, but I did go for a job interview there.
Oh, did you?
Once. Yeah, so that was in the days before I did the elocution lessons and a radio station would actually take chance on me. But I didn't get the job that was at Radio Orwell, but went for my interview at Electric House, and it was, I think, probably my first visit to Ipswich then. As you say, it just even now, that I still look at that building and think, well, that's Radio Orwell.
Yeah, yeah. You can see the sign now. There is a Facebook page, actually, called Remembering Radio Orwell, and seeing the old photos, I mean, it just seems like yesterday. Interesting for me, because when I arrived here today, I think it's Megan, the new young lady here, saying her first day. And my first day, 40-odd years ago, just seems like yesterday. It really does.
Yes.
But in other ways, it does seem quite a long time ago.
Yeah. And you were with Radio Orwell at the start, when they were starting up?
On day one, not really. I was sort of part-time working at the weekends and helping out on the sports show, which was legendary in those days. Just generally getting involved and, kept knocking on the door. And 1977 was the time when I was actually taken on full time at Rennie Warwell as a technical operator and presenter.
So who else would have been around that people will remember that you were working alongside in those days in the 70s?
Well, certainly one of my lifelong best friends, Patrick Ead, who is also from Ipswich. Who else? Andy Archer, Keith Rogers in those days, Greg Bance, Katie Glass, and then newer names like Melvin Pryor came along, Kevin Stewart, who nobody would ever forget. A whole host of people.
I think even a Mr. Stephen Foster passed
even
through their doors.
Mr. Stephen Foster. How can I forget Foz?
And, I think Radio Orwell was there wasn't that much. I mean, they weren't the first commercial radio station, of course, but they were quite new amongst commercial radio stations.
There was
very
few, and we had to do a bit of everything. I know there was a needle time restriction that meant that at certain times of the day you had to play music that didn't have performing rights and that sort of mm-hmm. thing attached to it. So it was quite different in those days. We didn't get the chance to play as much music as some of the stations probably do nowadays.
And for a station that is now probably thought of as primarily music, that must have been quite difficult.
Yeah, really. But we had a great following. I mean, they were great days for commercial radio. It was the beginning of it, really. And my first programme, I remember Patrick Ead, who I mentioned earlier on, was given the job of presenting the country music show that he just did not want to do at all, hated it with a passion, and that was just like an extra job for him. But Patrick was going on holiday, and I thought, there might be an opportunity here. I wonder if I can persuade the then programme controller to let me do the programme. So we had words, and about a week later he came back and said, yeah, OK, I'll let you have a go. And Patrick went on holiday for a couple of weeks. I did the show and never came off it. And despite all the different things I've done over the years, the country music show has always been the one thing that's been an extra feather in the cap, if you
yes.
like.
Yes, yeah. And I think you've certainly stood in a couple of times here on country music.
That's right. Yeah. And lucky enough to get a couple of awards as well. One in the late 70s, soon after the programme started, actually. And another one when I was down at BBC Essex before going over to the British Forces Network.
We'll talk more about where your radio career took you in a moment or two. We've got some travel news coming up, but first of all, though, and just also must mention, Anna from Bury St Edmunds has let us know that the A1065 between Barton Mills and Eriswell is closed due to an accident. I don't know whether Barry may have more details on that. Let's find out.
Travel news from BBC Radio Suffolk.
Barry, over to you.
Well, thanks very much, Claire. Just repeat what you say, really. Once Anna from Bury St Edmunds passed on the A1065 between Barton Mills and Eriswell, there's an accident which has closed the road, which is causing some local delays. Thanks again for your update on that, Anna. Much appreciated. Elsewhere across the county, not looking too bad. Maybe the High Street, Newmarket, quite slow. Northbound, especially, up towards the Fordham Road. Heading north up towards Ipswich is quite busy on the A12 at the Cop Dock Interchange. Crown Street and Yarmouth Road in Ipswich still looking a little bit congested. And Tom Crisp Way at Lowestoft, there's congestion just building on the northbound side now. On the railways, a trespass incident earlier at Manningtree. All the lines have reopened. Still expect some cancellations and possible 90-minute delays to Greater Anglia Rail services if you're travelling between Ipswich and Colchester. And if you are heading towards London, no service between Ingatestone and Liverpool Street in Greater Anglia. There are replacement buses there because of engineering works. I'm Barry Lewis for BBC Radio Suffolk Travel. If you see something or can update me, call 01477 3212121.
James Hazel in the morning on BBC Radio Suffolk.
Today on the show, football cliches then. I noticed on Sunday, he's a no-nonsense defender, that one. And I thought, as opposed to what, a nonsense defender? What are they on about? And then I listened out for them. Brian's been in touch, 110%. See, I don't mind that one. Helen also reminds us of this great one from commentators. He's come on with fresh legs. I love that one. Fresh legs.
Weekday mornings from 10 on BBC Radio Suffolk. Your station. Your BBC.
This is BBC Radio Suffolk. It's Claire Phillips with you in for Rachel Sloan this Friday afternoon and chatting to our sofa guest this afternoon, the broadcaster Nigel Rennie, who's been telling us about how he started off with BBC, with Radio Orwell. He's worked for the BBC as well, of course, and eventually went on to work for BFBS, the Forces Broadcasting, which we'll talk more about in a moment. We were talking about, Nigel, the early days of Radio Orwell and Electric House, but I think you also did a spell at Saxon Radio. Radio as well.
That's
which was
right.
Sort of younger brother of Radio Orwell in Bury St Edmunds.
Yeah, absolutely right. It was all part of the same company. And what a great place for a radio station as well. Quite small, mm-hmm. Quite a challenge, but just very much involved in the whole community there. And people just embraced everything that we did. It was a very small team based down the bottom of Long Brackland. in Bury St Edmunds, for anybody who knows that part of the world. It's now, I believe, the charity, it may be Mind, I can't remember, but it's certainly, it was an old co-op building, and then Saxon Radio took it over and had studios and whatever. But yeah, I believe it's a charity building now.
Yeah.
But great place to work, and really enjoyed it.
Yes, and from there, you continued with the same group, because of course it then became SGR, the whole sort of network.
Yeah.
Sort of merged together, didn't they?
That's when it got interesting, because nowadays there are still takeovers, but that was in the very early days of takeovers. And the radio station in Norwich, Radio Broadland, were knocking on the door of SGR in those days, and then that became one big group called East Anglian Radio, and then they were taken over by another group called GWR.
Yes.
And the rest is history.
Yes, who, of course, were very big in radio stations in the West Country.
That's right,
anyway.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's right.
Yeah, but you stayed with them during the various changes of name of station.
Yeah,
And I think you went on to SGR at Colchester.
That's right. So Saxon Radio, as it was in Bury St Edmunds, the whole operation came under one roof eventually, from just outside Ipswich. So that meant the closure of Saxon Radio and Bury St Edmunds, even though we're broadcasting to that area. And then the opportunity came to manage the station in Colchester, and I was down there for a few years as well. Really enjoyed that as well. Another nice town, and great response from the listeners down there.
And did you find as a manager, did you get opportunities to broadcast as well, or were you just
not
behind
so much,
the scenes?
Funny
then?
Enough, by then. We'd also set up another radio station called Amber Radio, which was a split of SGR, and that was broadcasting on the medium wave frequencies.
It was just one of those gold stations.
That's exactly right, yeah. So I was doing programmes on there and managing the Colchester station. Colchester was interesting in the fact that the military were very much in for, if you like, in Colchester, being a garrison town. And interesting that, you know, I shall go on to Forces Broadcasting soon after that.
So the two weren't connected then, the fact that you were in Colchester?
Not really,
Forces Broadcasting is in Colchester now as well.
Yeah, very much so, yeah.
Was it there at that time as well?
No, it wasn't. Mm-hmm. No, that was a development that happened sometime later. The British Forces Broadcasting Service, BFBS, was something I'd taken a keen interest in anyway. I had done some work for them previously in the form of interviews and that sort of thing. And when I left SGR, I went freelance for a little while. So I was doing BBC Essex and Radio Suffolk here, one or two stations down in Essex, and also BFBS. And the work I was getting from BFBS became more and more, and in the end it became my full-time job.
But that was UK based at that time, was it?
UK based for a couple of years. So I was doing the commute down to Buckinghamshire, where the headquarters is. And then 2002, the big boss there asked if I might be interested in a posting overseas with the family, and this was to Cyprus. And quite a big move at that time, because my two daughters were 10 and 8 at the time.
Yeah, so that's a big step to take, isn't it?
Yeah, because it wasn't just me, Claire. It was the whole family that I had to take into consideration, and, you know, what their futures were going to hold and that sort of thing. So we went there on the two-year posting in 2002. And stayed there for 10 years.
Wow, so you obviously liked it.
And fortunately, you know, the powers that be liked what I did. So, yeah, we stayed there for quite a long time.
So how did it work with things like your children's schools, for example? Because, you know, I suppose at 10 and 8, it's not, you know, they weren't in the middle of key exams or something like that.
No, we were very lucky, Claire, because anybody who's involved with the military and has had postings out to Cyprus will know the service children's education schools. So based on exactly the same curriculum. So in all the bases in Cyprus, there's what they call the Western Sovereign Base area, which is RAF, Akrotiri and Episcopi. And then the Eastern Sovereign Base area, which is Decalia and a place called Ayas Nikolaos. So separate schools in those areas. And my girls went to the Decalia Primary School initially, and then on to the high school, and both did well.
And I guess you're sort of on bases with lots of other service families out there.
Yeah.
So you're living very much the military lifestyle, are you?
Absolutely. And you're right among the audience. I mean, it's an experience that is very difficult to explain to people, but you were never away from the audience. Mm. Had its advantages and sometimes maybe a disadvantage, but they were so loyal. I mean, the military, the work they do is just fantastic. You learn a lot about the military. I'd never had any ambition to be in the military personally, but I admire so much what they do. It was a great way to find out about what makes them tick. And they really did appreciate what we did for them.
Well, we'll hear more about your career with the Forces Broadcasting. I know that after Cyprus, you went to various other parts of the world as well. Take a break for some music, first of all, though. It's BBC Radio Suffolk. Claire Phillips in for Rachel this afternoon. This is The Beatles. Beatles, Can't Buy Me Love. It's BBC Radio Suffolk. 29 minutes to four, and Nigel Rennie is here talking about his broadcasting career. We've been hearing about his time in Cyprus. Before we move on, Nigel, Leslie always invites her sofa guests to answer a couple of key questions. Have a rummage in our keys box.
Have a little shuffle.
And have a read of what's on one of the labels.
Pick
there.
Pick one out at random.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Oh, good heavens. Tell us about your first kiss.
Well, that'll
be an interesting thing. That will probably take me back to school days, but I won't say any more about that at the moment.
Right.
Just in case anybody in the family is listening. But yep, back in my school days.
Somebody had a crush on, was it?
I think it may well have been,
yes. Well, we'll have another key question in just a moment or two, but we were hearing about your time in Cyprus. It started off as 2 years, ended up as 10 years out there. And did you go anywhere else during that time, or were you simply in Cyprus?
Well, interesting enough, after I went out to Cyprus, I'd only been there about a month and had the opportunity to go to the Jordanian desert where the military from Cyprus were doing some exercises with the Jordanian army. So I went out there for a couple of weeks, which was just an amazing experience, something that was totally alien to me at the time. But you learn very quickly. And if you can imagine being out in the middle of nowhere in the desert, and particularly at night time, if you want to go to the loo or something like that, there's no, you know, nice toilets.
Yeah.
You walk along the desert for a way and behind some tarpaulin and there you go. There's probably somebody else in there with you.
And probably all sorts of, I don't know, snakes and spiders and all kinds of things like
and
that.
And howling, Claire. Yeah. I remember, you know, wolves howling in the distance.
Gosh, how scary. did your work ever take you into sort of conflict areas as well, or were you very much kind of entertaining the troops, as it were?
It could have done, and I must say it wasn't that I never wanted to, because a lot of my colleagues went off to places like Iraq and Afghanistan. When those conflicts were going on, I seemed to be used to fill gaps, if that makes sense. So if there was a colleague, for example, in Gibraltar, particularly wanted to go out to Afghanistan, then I was brought in for 6 months to cover his role while he was away. Mm-hmm. So I didn't actually go to those places such as Afghanistan and Iraq, but it wasn't necessarily through choice. It was the boss's decision at the end of the day.
Because the Forces Broadcasting, I suppose it's there to sort of inform the forces, but also
yes.
at difficult times when there's a conflict on, it must have a quite a sensitive role to play.
Yeah, I mean, it's part of the welfare package. That's the whole point of it. And BFBS, British Forces Broadcasting Service, is actually a registered charity. Totally independent. But, was one of those places where you had to be careful at times. And I spent time in the Falkland Islands, and it was one of those locations where you knew how far you could push it regarding interviews. Mm. You didn't want to get anything too controversial because, you know, you never knew who was listening in, basically.
Yes.
So you used common sense as much as anything else. And there was a great rapport between BFBS and the command. And, you know, let's put it this way. If you pushed it too far and you made a horrendous mistake, you'd be on the first plane out.
Yeah.
So it was all to do with respect.
And I imagine that there would also have been difficult times where, you know, if some in a war situation, you know, there'd been a big loss to the military, or, you know, things hadn't gone well, grieving families back at home. And we all saw, you know, people the coffins coming back to Wootton Bassett during the various conflicts, and the people lining the streets. But back on the bases, it must have been even more difficult times in those sort of situations.
It was gauging the mood. And when it comes to playing music, you just had to be a little bit careful. You know, we had a playlist, but you look carefully through what the songs were, and clearly you didn't want to play something inappropriate at the wrong time.
And you sort of went from, well, you mentioned the Falkland Islands, and that was, when was that you were out there? Because presumably that was long after the actual conflict of the...
Oh, yes. That was, 5 years ago now. Mm-hmm. So while I was still in Cyprus, I was posted to Gibraltar for 6 months to cover for the manager's role there. Then I was back for another 6 months, and then to Brunei, which is a really interesting place. And then to the Falkland Islands in a year. It would actually have just been over a year, but an interesting Christmas. This was 4 years ago now. As you probably know, the Falklands is very isolated, and there's two planes coming in and out each week, RAF planes. And it was a bit of a difficult time for us as a family, because I was there unaccompanied, and Bev and the girls by then were back in the UK. And I knew my dad was ill, and sadly passed away on the 23rd of December. And bearing in mind, you know, you can't just jump on a plane straight back. I had to stay there for Christmas and then got back just before New Year. So that became one of the challenges of being on an overseas posting. Mm. Many benefits, but at times just a little bit challenging as well.
Yes, and particularly with the rest of your family back in the UK.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, yeah.
And you were next sent to Canada. And did the family go to Canada with you?
My wife Bev came to Canada. By then, my girls both at university. So little girls as they were in Cyprus, both grown up and both working now. But the opportunity came to go to Canada, and the army have a big training area in southern Alberta, which I have to say is very isolated. But you know, 3 hours drive and you're in the Rocky Mountains. And it's the most beautiful part of the world I think I've ever been to. Mm. We worked hard, and once again, it was one of these bases that was out in the middle of nowhere, basically. So, you know, a captive audience, but it was that link with home again, and people really did embrace what BFBS Canada was all about and seemed to enjoy what we did. But, of course, any spare time, you know, you didn't want to be just sitting out on the prairie twiddling your thumbs. You wanted to be out touring around. So we had lots of great visits up to the Rockies, Banff, Lake Louise, and Jasper. We did a road trip to Vancouver and Seattle, and down to Yellowstone National Park. So it was a great opportunity.
Yeah, fantastic opportunity to see all those places. But also, as you've sort of hinted, you know, family upheaval. Your wife and family came back to Suffolk. Then you and your wife went back out to Canada. So no real sort of putting down roots for quite a long time.
No, there was a time, Claire, when my wife Bev was living with sister-in-law and brother-in-law. Both girls, one was in Manchester, the other in Liverpool, and me in the Falkland Islands.
Mm.
But it's the way that the military live. You know, it gave you a real understanding of of what military life is all about. And I think it's very tough. Okay, it's the job, and you know, that's what they expect. But for the families, yeah, it can be quite tough.
Yeah, we'll hear one of your favourite records in a moment. I'll let you introduce it. But before
all
we
right.
do that, we'll have another key question, if you wouldn't mind.
Let's go to this one, shall we? Oh, that's interesting. Excuse me. Uniform or civvies?
Well, they must have known you were coming in today.
Yeah. Well, I've never worn a uniform, mm-hmm. so it has to be the latter,
civvies. But you have sort of lived on that military lifestyle. And you know, if one of your daughters had said, I want to join the military, would you have encouraged her?
Do you know, I wouldn't have been against it at all. You know, there again, they both really admire what the military do, but haven't gone into the forces. But it gives you a great understanding of what they do. And there's some great careers. Anybody thinking about it, just do it. There's some great opportunities.
Yeah. It's certainly a career, isn't it? It's something you do, I mean, obviously, people come out of the army after a certain period of time.
And it's changing as well, Claire, because there's not so many opportunities for the military people to go overseas anymore because more and more is being based back in the UK now.
We're getting a lot of calls from listeners saying how much they're enjoying hearing you on the radio. Barry Dye has remembering you from Radio Orwell, and Brian and Jill Betts from Ipswich wish you a happy new year as well.
That's very nice.
Lovely to hear so many callers to BBC Radio Suffolk this afternoon. I know that when Rachel invited you in today, she asked you for your favourite record. Would you like to introduce it?
And it was very difficult to come up with an actual favourite because I love music. As you probably know, I enjoy my country music as well, but this has to be probably my all-time favourite, the Beach Boys.
I may not always love you, but long as there are stars above you, you never need to doubt it. I'll make you so.
That's the Beach Boys and God Only Knows. It's 16 minutes to four here on BBC Radio Suffolk. Nigel Rennie has been our sofa guest this afternoon, talking about his career in broadcasting. Nigel, have you hung up your headphones?
No, not yet. It's interesting. I'm at that particular age, I suppose, where you know you've had a long career and it can't possibly go on forever. But the thought of not doing radio anymore, that's not on the radar. But obviously, you know, I've got to be realistic, and the work I've done in recent years has been broadcasting, but also on the management side and charity side as well. We did a lot of charity work, just looking for some new opportunities to keep me occupied in 2017.
But getting settled back into the UK life, because you've left Canada now.
Yeah, and that was always an aim of ours. We'd been away for 14 years, really enjoyed it. It was a big move. But the time comes when you want your own home again. And we've got relatives and friends in this part of the world. And it was always going to be the place where we came back to. Not any particular place, I hasten to add, but anywhere in Suffolk. And we looked around, and we're now living not too far from Ipswich.
Yeah, because I suppose, initially one would wonder whether when you first got that opportunity to go abroad, do you think, do we sell up everything or do we wait and see what happens?
But, we didn't sell up. We kept our home near Stowmarket. And that was probably the best thing we did, actually, because, you know, once you're off the property market, it's quite difficult to get back on again.
And again, not knowing, I suppose, you know, they told you it was 2 years.
You
might have been home and knocking on the door here again.
But you never know. Yeah, but 14 years later, I mean, you know, it doesn't seem like 14 years. It's been fantastic. The highlights of my career, there's just so many. But the recent times with British Forces Broadcasting Service and in Canada in particular was just the final icing on the cake, if you like. But it was time to move on.
You're getting everyone ringing in to say how lovely it is on the radio. Rob Chandler.
Bless him. And, my old mate Rob.
He says that you share the same favourite song by the Beach Boys as well.
You never know
who's listening in.
No. And Rob, I've known for a long time. Another Radio Orwell colleague who's gone on to great things and still going strong as well.
Well, it's been lovely seeing you here in the studio, and I know that, as you say, you're settling back into Suffolk life, and it's not all about radio, is it? You've just mentioned you've got a puppy that...
A black lab called Maple, named after our time in Canada. I think people keep thinking we're saying the dog's called Mabel, but it's definitely Maple. And he's a major part of the family. He's been with us for a couple of months now. And some of the walks in Suffolk are just great, ideal for dogs.
Great for getting you out and about in the countryside,
absolutely,
dogs, aren't they?
Absolutely.
And if he's still a pup, then probably full of energy and...
And getting bigger all the time, Claire. He is a pup, but he's, 5 months old now? He's got big paws. He's going to be a big boy.
Yes, yeah. Well, the training going well, is it?
And he, funny enough, which is great for me, he loves going to the pub.
Well, you picked the right dog there.
Yeah, we've got one or two favourite pubs that we like going to, and he just sits under the table. And, lets us get on with it.
Our dog likes going to the pub. In fact, so much so, embarrassingly, that when we're both at work and the dog walker comes to take her for a walk, the dog runs straight down the road to the pub and stands in the door. But if they're not at home,
This
is where they must be. They can, you know, you can't fool them sometimes.
Yeah.
Well, it's lovely to see you, Nigel. And you know, it's obviously been an amazing time in Canada. I'm so envious of all the travelling that you've done. And I'm sure it won't be too long before we hear you on a radio not far away.
You never know. Just keep listening out.
Thanks very much for coming in.
Thank you very much, Claire. That's Appreciate it.
Nigel Rennie, formerly of this parish and indeed other stations in the local area, notably Radio Orwell, of course. Thank you to everyone who's called in this afternoon as well, saying they've enjoyed listening to Nigel.